now I'm glad to introduce you the person whom you know already. She's Kristiāna ĀBELE, our host and main organizer of this conference. She's the senior researcher at the Institute of Art History at the Art Academy. And she's an expert in the 19th century, and this long 19th century art and architecture in the
Dear colleagues, dear colleagues, on the first slide of my presentation, you can read two very similar short statements by two gentlemen about their activities. The upper one says, I'm missing here a lot about with Latvian artists. I have made something like a dictionary of Latvian artists with more than 1,000 of them in there. And the lower one, in that autumn I made up a plan to collect materials for a dictionary of Baltic artists, just of fine arts, but I have been doing diligently ever since then and keep doing now. Think a moment when and by whom these lines may have been written, so similar that they could be even exchanged and confused, if not for the terms Latvian and Baltic, and even these small ethnic and territorial hints would be not sufficient for accurate chronological attribution. Unveiling some of the truth, I will reveal at first that the two statements are separated from each other by a gap of a century. The upper one dates to Soviet time Riga in the early 1960s. The lower one was recorded in Jelgava in 1865 with a reference to the year 1855. The messing about with Latvian artists in 1962 was outlined in a letter by the aged literary critic and historian Alfred Buba to the widower artist Alexander Strauss. The idea to compile a dictionary of Baltic artists in 1855 became one of the lifetime preoccupations for Peter Julius Dürling in Jelgava. When the previous slides were flashing by, you could perhaps notice how surprisingly similar these two gentlemen look as they were the seniors with the round glasses. Just as with the previous quotes, it would be quite easy to mistake one for the other, or still more likely to imagine them both as age mates living in the same time, exchanging long detailed letters about the progress of their projects, and immersing in overnight discussions when seeing each other. In a sense, my presentation will be a tribute to these two men who, apart from their other occupations, were passionate chroniclers and amateur art historians. Their work has been widely, although still not sufficiently, exploited by professionals and simultaneously treated with certain arrogance. In the case of Dürling already by Wilhelm Neumann, and in the case of Buba by Soviet and contemporary researchers of art, including myself. Some aspects of the subject were addressed first in paper The Eastern Baltic Dictionary of Artists by Julius Dürling and its continuity in art reference literature in the region that I delivered in Latvian at the conference dedicated to the bicentenary of the Courland Society of Literature and Art in January of the last year. The resulting discussion and dragging him to a still unexplored branch of the family tree, as well as the remaining mysteries associated with this material, inspired me to go on with my research in this field of biographical dictionaries, the seemingly simple yet indispensable job of art writing. Where professional art history often encounters amateurship, attempting to eradicate it and at the same time profiting from its contributions. As you will see, some quests so far have been unsuccessful with regard to missing links, namely lost manuscripts, but at the same time, the reconstructed scene as a whole is rich and convincing enough to prove that the history of Repkin's works about artists of and from the former Baltic provinces in general and Latvia in particular is not a contract development from primitive to increasingly elaborate and comprehensive works where every next stage outdates the previous versions. It would be more accurate to outline this development as a family tree where all members have something in common, but every successive generation has been raised with limited access to family archives and fragmentary knowledge about its actual lineage, also containing side branches and obscure elements. Thus, clues to biographical information for exploring the art of Latvia are not concentrated solely in the single Latvian editorial teamwork of the kind, the four-volume dictionary Art and Architecture in Biographies published between the mid-90s and 2003 with a change towards a more elaborate and comprehensive editorial concept after the first two volumes. Such clues also remain dispersed in published and unpublished works of this kind that, to the contrary, resulted from solitary ambitions. For almost all of the first first source information about creators of art in Baltic provinces by the beginning of the 20th century will be the so-called Neumann dictionary, the Lexikon Baltischer Künstler, namely the dictionary of Baltic artists, prepared by art historian Wilhelm Neumann and published in 1908. This reference work now is not only available in its original edition by Jonk and Polevski in Riga, or in Harald von Hirschheit's reprint from 1972, but can also be downloaded at some of the many increasing online libraries. In the foreword of this publication, Neumann, however, pointed out that the work is based on a manuscript by painter Julius Düring, acquired by the Kurland Society for Literature and Art. According to Neumann, this source material was not completely finished, replete with both factual gaps and unimportant details, but simultaneously indispensable for further elaboration. After Düring's death at the age of 80 in Jelgava in 1898, more than 50 years after his move from Dresden to Kurland, the newspaper Dune Zeitung described him as a painter, historian, archaeologist, and teacher, emphasizing the manuscript of the Baltic Artist's Dictionary as the peak of his extensive activities. The unrevealed writer claimed that already as far back as 1882, this dictionary contained 900 entries, and he was wondering why it has not been published since then, because, I quote, The still missing history of Baltic art and artists can be written only on the ground of such a collection. As you know from the introduction of my talk, the work was begun already in 1855. During was exceptionally meticulous also in terms of self-documenting. And the note about starting the dictionary with Baltic artists 10 years later was included in his dictionary, in his voluminous autobiography, what I would not like to forget or recollections of my life. Based on still more detailed diary notes of his first period in Courland. The slide shows first the particular fragment of the very accurate manuscript, ethnic style remind about the recent publication of these recollections by the Latvian State History Archive of the National Archives of Latvia, available both in German and Latvian, translated by the experienced archivist and Germanist Valda Kraskova and commented by here and her expert colleague Parslo Peterson. In 1873, actually 18 years from the start, Duvek filled four large-size notebooks with these 900 and alphabetically listed and numbered biographical entries. For new names in the course of the next 20 years, a combination of numbers and letters was used. For example, 630A for Janis Rosenthal and 845A for Johann Walter. A relatively small part of notes provided information for biographies of Baltic work or Baltic-based artists in the catalog of the painting exhibition in Jelgava in 1894. Ultimately, at the close of his life, most likely basically in 1896, Duvek organized the whole collection into three manuscript books entitled Ostbaltisches Künstlerlexikon, Eastern Baltic Dictionary of Artists. They were preserved by the Courland Society for Literature and Art and can be studied in the collections of this organization at the Latvian State History Archive. In 1898, Duvek died. And soon after his death, the Courland Society for Literature and Art entrusted the manuscript of the dictionary to Wilhelm Neumann, who, among others, was the architect of the new Courland Province Museum. Dr. Neumann promised to prepare it for publication, and press reports from 1900 tell that the dictionary then was expected very soon, with a supplement about Baltic goldsmiths and bell founders. The Riga Art Society was planning the retrospective exhibition of Baltic art on the 700th anniversary of the city next summer, namely in 1901, and such a dictionary seemed that it could have become a very welcome addition to the intended historical program. Nevertheless, the reference work was left behind by Neumann's collection of biographical essays, Baltic paintings and sculptors in the 19th century that was inspired by the anniversary exhibition of Baltic artists of all times and became the first large-scale art book produced in a local printing house as well as by the promised inventory of goldsmiths. 10 years had to pass from Duvek's death when Neumann was ready to write an introduction to the dictionary whose publication was co-financed by learned societies of Riga, Jelgava, Tallinn, and Tartu. The dictionary contained information about artists and architects who were either born in the Baltics or had arrived to work here. Goldsmiths were not included with the excuse that they are already represented in a recent publication by Neumann. Obviously, The revision of the manuscript according to the professional standards of the editor was more time-consuming than one could expect. Neumann supplemented it with information from art reference works, archive files of the Dresden Academy, and other sources that had not been accessible to the old member from Jelgava. Some of his advisors were Anton Buchholz, Leonid Abuzov, the city librarian Nikolai Busch, and the archivist and genealogist Gottfried von Thürne from Tallinn. Neumann removed numerous details that he found irrelevant for a proper dictionary of artists and revised the list of entries. His involvement and interference, both praiseworthy and disputable, turned into something more than mere editorial publishing, polishing. Generally, the result was a representational reference work. At the same time, we have a brilliant opportunity to explore the process of revision, as Döring's manuscript was returned to its holders in the Courland Province Museum, spotted with Neumann's notes. He had numbered the entries, reaching the number 1,271, and expanded a part of them, crossing out many other ones and sometimes commenting on his actions. There may have been many grounds to become angry, because Döring was writing, for instance, in the following manner. Ozendal, young Latvian, born in Saldus, student of the Imperial Academy of Art in St. Petersburg, visited the museum in Jelgava on 24th June 1892. In 1896 in Riga, he exhibited his charge corps after the service, who received lots of praise. Just a small part of these facts were relevant for a proper dictionary that required a different form of narration. In the course of revision, Neumann also removed references to ethnicity, as in the case of Rosenthal's, a transformation that was later noticed and criticized by art historian Wiswald Spendrift. Another example, during Döring's this time on Johann Walter. In the summer of 1895, he returned to Jelgava, where he exhibited a view of Jelgava with a posing peasant woman, 1 foot wide and 1 foot and a third high, for 50 rubles, including the golden frame. In November, he was in St. Petersburg again, and in December, back in Jelgava. Döring had recorded a portrait from Riga, who had made drawings for the Pope's album in 1888, namely Vittoria Mariana. Neumann supplemented the entry with the artist's first name. Bernhard, his specialty as painter or illustrator, and a birthday that made him a year younger than he actually was, causing a chain of errors throughout the whole century. About Bernhard's father, Döring had recorded just the fact of his marriage and that he is or was an architect. Neumann, however, crossed the short entry out, noting that this man, according to information obtained from his son, was just a building contractor without ambitions to be an artist. Although Neumann's dictionary included architects, he eliminated not only himself, but also, for example, Reinhold Mulecke from Döring's list of entries. Exclusion of Neumann himself, with no regard of his prominent achievements, still could be explained as an expression of gentlemanly restraint. In many other cases, the professional specialization of particular persons did not meet Neumann's ideas about the limits of high art, but had seemed sufficiently artistic to the supposedly conservative 19th century man Döring, who in this regard actually was ahead of most of his contemporaries. Thus, for example, the left page in the same spread where the father and son Borchardt were described features two entries about photographers marked as deleted by Neumann. One of them, the famous Robert Bodhart, made the following photographic portrait of woodcarver Georg Franz Bernhard, who in Neumann's opinion obviously had to be treated as a craftsman below the standards of proper art. Nevertheless, the life and work of Bernhard recently was reconstructed in a vast context of cloth revival in 19th century art. This article by my colleague Diana Latz, however, is by far not the only indicator that Düring's collection of biographies deserves to be re-examined for different purposes. A publication abounding in such evidences certainly is the comprehensive catalogue portrait in Latvia in the 19th century, combining elements of a collective monograph, catalogue, and a biographical dictionary of not just artists but also of models. Furthermore, I would like to outline a specific aspect in which Düring might have helped us in the work on the turn of the 20th century volume of the Art History of Latvia, published 2 years ago. One of the most complicated problems to solve in the process of work was the research of Riga German stage designers of the late 19th and early 20th centuries, starting from establishing their names. As it turned out, that only one of them happened to be included in Neumann's dictionary. It would have been much easier to extract relevant fragments of information from newspaper reviews of performances if we had managed to notice that Düring was writing about these masters who were typically considered as members of the technical staff. Richard Patzig, who later worked with Richard Wagner in Bayreuth, was described as painter of decorations in the theater of Riga in 1890 and already earlier, born in Zurich, painted a theater curtain for the Trade Society in Galgova in 1891, and so on, with a lot of occasional detail, but more than one can get from other sources. The opinion of Latvian artist and critic Julius Madernieks, famous for his first style, about Neumann's dictionary, was very sharp. A dictionary of this kind has little importance, and it can be used only as a material for better and more serious works. Madernieks was unable to understand why the dictionary includes many little-known masters whose names, as he wrote, are just mentioned in some old church records, or a sculptor who has made a single memorial tablet for the Dom Cathedral, or an architect who has made a sketch for the city called Tartu. Latvian critic wrote sarcastically that we, meaning like us Latvians, could nearly approach the scale of the large encyclopedia, the Große Konversationslexikon, and surpass the biggest cultural nations if one is recognized as an artist for such a literally minor achievement. From the far Biden century. The list of artists should have been much longer. Latvian society at that time predominantly treated the art and architecture monuments of the previous centuries as alien. And art history facts and names from old records still seemed insignificant to them. Neumann himself, however, was conscious of chronological unevenness in the work. He recognized it in the foreword and explained with vain attempts to receive the required information from a number of contemporaries. Madernich charged Neumann with biased one-sidedness, nevertheless he himself was still more biased in his neglect of an important reference work that had to write for serious continuity in the writing of Estonians, Latvians, and recently Baltic Germans until the second half of the 20th, actually the last part of the 20th century. Regardless of the chosen selection criteria, authors of these works saw themselves as successors of Neumann. As Düring's manuscript in the Latvian State History Archive contains Neumann's notes, the Herder Institute in Marburg holds a copy of Neumann's dictionary, stuffed with supplements by architecture and art historian Paul Kompe, turning the book into an impressive three-dimensional object. When I came to see this curiosity in situ, by the initial information obtained from Dr. Peter Burster, the curator of document collections at the Institute, the unique Neumann-Kampe dictionary was already explored in one particular respect, namely with regard to new materials about women artists from Latvia, and it was done by another presenter of our session, Baiba Banaga, for her dissertation. Supposedly, Kampe envisaged a revised edition of Neumann's work parallel to his own dictionary of master builders, building craftsmen, and building designers in Livonia and Courland. A combination of a biographical dictionary and chronology published in 100 copies in Stockholm in the 1950s. Kampe's parallel biographical discoveries remained unknown to Kuno Hagen, a Riga-born engineer in Erlangen, whose dictionary of Baltic German artists of the 20th century is the published sequel of Neumann's dictionary. After the re-establishment of independent Baltic states, the Biographical Dictionary of Estonian Art and Architecture was published in Tallinn in 1996, and the first two volumes of Latvian Art and Architecture and Biographies II appeared around the same time in the mid-90s. In its second phase of development, it underwent serious transformations with particular regard to contemporary art scene, whose representation would have pleased Julius Modernis, but also with regard to the past, what meant above all the delayed inclusion of photographers. Nevertheless, the number of artists who had worked in traditional media and were recognized by Düring and Neumann were left outside the covers, referring to insufficiency of visual evidence and disregarding published accounts, whereas a single positive mention in any periodical source would have been enough for the inclusion of the respective artist in Hagen's dictionary. Both in terms of design and of selection criteria, the Art and Architecture and Biographies tried to meet Latvian unconscious standards of convincing visualization, and this meant that Master just mentioned or church efforts. If we remember reports by Modernics and many other authors who worked before the time of the richly illustrated Baltic art yearbook, built at the Kunst in den Ostseeprovinz, were discarded as irrelevant, although later discoveries sometimes made the diligent editor Ant Monaga regret these previous choices. Be that as it may, all these published dictionaries can be classified as companions of Neumann's dictionary in the sections of reference literature in our libraries. The unwittingly closest Latvian colleague of Düring, however, can be recognized in the above-mentioned Albrecht Glober, and it is with him that the most obscure episodes of my story are associated. As we know from his own statements, he managed to make something like a dictionary of Latvian artists with over 1,000 entries focusing on less known names. It is important, less known names, even such authors whom we don't call artists. As this aged Latvian Düring elaborated his manuscript in Soviet Latvia of the early 1960s, we can be sure that some of Glober's less known names have risen to prominence ever since. According to another reference for Latvian literature and biographies, Glober's encyclopedic ambitions resulted totally in manuscripts for a dictionary of literature in 14 volumes, dictionary of Latvian artists in 3 volumes, history of Latvian art in 6 volumes, and Latvian thinkers in 4 volumes. Although sections of his abundant legacy held by various institutions contain many notes other materials supposed for the dictionary part and the history part, I have so far failed to find the main result of his late art historical interests. Wobbe's correspondence, however, proves that he managed to implement these ideas, resulting in bound typewritten volumes produced in a small number of copies. My own first link to Wobbe's legacy was established during my research about one of the less known names, the artist Peter Strastinj, for an MA paper and later the book that was published by Nebuchadnezzar 10 years ago. It was more than surprising to discover that this strange gentleman even dreamed about a little album of Krastinj's unusual works in a time when they were completely hidden from general public. In the research history of my book, I mentioned Wobbe with gratitude and respect for his solitary efforts that provided indispensable material for later studies. But at the same time, I was conscious of my professional superiority of an art historian who is selecting, evaluating, and comparing the objects of investigation. As the time goes on, I'm no more quite sure if I was right in my position. Wobbe's focus on less known names, even such authors whom we don't call artists, inspires me to continue the search for his dictionary. At the same time, it can be applied to some significant stops in this little walk through the history of our art reference literature, paying homage to some whom we don't call art historians, but who have given us a lot of important research material combining peculiar qualities of old-fashioned amateurship with surprisingly unconventional concepts of art and artists ahead of their time. Thank you.